vow that was the judiciary is no longer sacred. It stopped being sacred the day a sitting Chief Justice of this country was accused of sexual harassment, presided over his own trial, cleared himself, and then proceeded to accept a nomination to the upper house within 3 months of retirement, replete with Z-plus security cover.
One second, please.
He cannot discuss.
Please, the house.
Chief Justice of India को हम लोग यहाँ discuss कर रहे हैं sir. Chief Justice of India, भारत के राष्ट्रपति ने उस आदमी को nominate किया है. भारत के राष्ट्रपति के ऊपर discussion कर रहे हैं sir. और यदि इसी तरह से चलता रहा तो इस डेमोक्रेसी का बाजा बच जाएगा. इसीलिए कि उन्होंने राम मंदिर का
I rise today to speak against the motion and in support of the amendments moved by my party to the Honourable President's address. Far too many of our fellow citizens today languish in jail or bear the burden of judicial and police harassment simply for asking questions of this government or choosing to voice an opinion on the state of affairs in our country. So I, as a parliamentarian, garbed in parliamentary privilege, now choose to use this platform that the people have given me to ask the questions that the people want to ask and to give voice to their thoughts so that this government may know that arresting, attacking and repressing voices will not hold. I trust my honourable colleagues on the treasury benches will not shout me down, that you, Mr. Honourable Chairman, sir, will let me speak for the entirety of my allotted time and that Lok Sabha TV, paid for by taxpayers' money, will not turn the screens off. The American journalist Elmer Davis's words about the United States are just as relevant to the celebration of the 72nd anniversary of the birth of our republic. That this republic was not created by cowards, and cowards will not preserve it. So today, I speak of cowardice and courage and of the difference between the two. Of those cowards who hide behind the false bravado of authority, of power, of hate, of bigotry, of untruths, and dare to call it courage. After all, this government has turned propaganda and disinformation into a cottage industry, whose biggest success is the recasting of cowardice as courage. I will lay out various instances where this government has demonstrated courage. The government claims it has shown courage to bring in a law that questions on arbitrary parameters who is or who isn't an Indian. The Citizenship Amendment Act was passed in 2019 in this House on the pretext of granting citizenship to persecuted Hindus and other minorities in neighbouring countries. At the same time, it threw into an abyss of insecurity millions of Indians who had been living in this land for generations. But the rules by which this Act will be implemented were not yet prepared by December 2020, according to the Ministry of Home Affairs. The deadline has yet again been extended till April 2020. If indeed this government cares so much for those persecuted in neighbouring countries, why does it miss deadline after deadline to notify these rules? And meanwhile, very many of us have mustered the courage to tell the government, "Kagaz nahi dikhayenge." Trying to exert central influence over Shantiniketan, Tagore's Haven, is not enough to change your colours. Only a small portion of Jana Gana Mana was adopted as our national anthem. I urge the government to read the rest of it. Maybe it will help you understand Tagore, as you call him, and Bengal a little better. My colleague, the respected floor leader of the Congress Party, happened to also quote these very words. But I think repeating them over and over again would do our nation some good. অহরহ তব আও ভান প্রচারিত শুনিতব উদার বাণী হিন্দু বৌদ্ধ বৌদ্ধ শিখ জৈন পারসিক মুসলমান ও খ্রিস্টানি পূরব পশ্চিম আসে তব সিংহাসন পাশে গাহে প্রেমহার হয় গাথা জনগণ ঐক্য বিধায়ক জয় হে হেল ইউনিটি হেল রিলিজিয়াস ডাইভার্সিটি দ্য কারেজ টু মেক ইন্ডিয়া দ্য ওয়ার্ল্ডস গ্রেটেস্ট ডেমোক্রেসি ইন টু আ ভার্চুয়াল পুলিশ স্টেট whereby a single dubious complaint, both an eminent member of this House, as well as one of India's most veteran journalists, is charged with sedition? The courage to try and take over every state government by hook or by crook, whether you have won the popular mandate or not. You claimed you were wedded to constructive cooperation and cooperative federalism. Instead of partnering with state governments, you try and muscle them out at every opportunity. Does the ruling party wish that its legacy be that it governed the largest democracy in the world or that it imposed a one-party rule in India? Ask yourselves. The courage to announce a national lockdown at only 4 hours' notice, causing untold misery, countless deaths, the sight of thousands walking for hundreds of miles with no food or money. This government spent less than 2% on social transfers, in contrast to OECD countries who spent 20% and 6% which was spent by middle-income countries. The courage, no, the brazen audacity to announce an economic rebound? India was the single worst performer among developing countries in the year 2020. Even if we believe this government's economic survey, the economy will lower by 7.7% in 2020 and will rise by 11% in 2021. So in effect, by 2022, that is over a two-year time span, the economy will be flat, just at the 2019 GDP number. The survey proclaims that growth is the biggest poverty alleviator. Honourable members of this House, we are going to have no growth for two whole years. I don't understand the celebration. I come from a rural constituency and a source for migrant workers. The distress in the MSME sector is real. This rebound is one where large, strong enterprises have become stronger. It is not V-shaped, it is K-shaped. 1% of rich and successful citizens have become richer, and the pains of the MSMEs have only increased. The government had the courage to say that it gave 1,13,000 crores via the direct benefit transfer scheme, only to take the same money away from those very same people and the middle class in the way of increased cess on petrol and diesel. We are not a nation that is growing and sharing its wealth. We seem to be a nation that is only finding ways to share our poverty. The hype today is that post-budget, the Sensex jumped. In a country where only 6 crore people pay taxes, only 4.6% of the total population, how many do you think are invested in the Sensex that they should jump for joy when the Sensex jumps? The courage to use the official channels of the Ministry of External Affairs to respond to social media posts by an 18-year-old climate activist and an American pop star, where not even one single ministry has been deputed by this government to try and look out for the food, water and basic sanitation needs of the farmers and their families who have been camping at the border for almost 90 days. And finally, the courage to bring in 3 farm laws when the opposition, farmers across the country, as well as the government's oldest ally, warned it was unacceptable. I wish to remind this government that India, under Prime Minister Lal Bahadur Shastri, committed 3 things to Sant Fateh Singh, the Akali leader. The creation of a Punjabi-speaking state, open-ended public procurement, and an assured return on agricultural produce. These farm laws threatened to snatch away 2 of these guarantees. These laws were arrived at without consensus, tabled without scrutiny, and rammed down this nation's throat with the brute force of the Treasury benches. They have firmly established this government's motto of brutality over morality. And everyone else in this country has been portrayed as a coward or a terrorist, from the farmers to the students to the old ladies of Shaheen Bagh. You say you have courage. You claim you have done so many things that no other government before you has done. Yes, that is true. In true fascist fashion, you have made every act of pettiness, of vengeance, of hate, of bigotry, a part of your narrative of courage. The reason no one has done it before you is not because no one had the courage, but simply because it was not the right thing to do. Has that thought ever struck you? And India's tragedy today is not just that her government has failed her, but that her other democratic pillars, the media and the judiciary, have failed her too. Lord Hayne, the Labour peer, said in the House of Lords, "What is the point of being a member of Parliament, either in the Commons or in the Lords, if you don't discharge your responsibilities and, where appropriate, use the privileges that you have in order to promote justice and liberty?" So today, like a true child of Bengal, I will stand here and be courageous. Trust me, Mr. Balu, we have not lost the fighting spirit. Even though the government spin factories will later portray it as cowardice or even plagiarism, I will lay out a few home truths by using my parliamentary privilege that guards me from charges of sedition and contempt for anything I say in this House. And Mr. Law Minister, sir, if you're present on the premises, with all due respect, this time you have neither the right to shut me up nor to try and get my words expunged from the record. The sacred cow that was the judiciary is no longer sacred. It stopped being sacred the day a sitting Chief Justice of this country was accused of sexual harassment, presided over his own trial, cleared himself, and then proceeded to accept a nomination to the upper house within 3 months of retirement, replete with Z-plus security cover. The judiciary stopped being sacred when it chose to squander the greatest opportunity that any bench of the highest court of this land has ever seen to reinforce the founding principles of our democratic republic and to uphold the rights enshrined in Part 3 of our constitution.
One second, please move.
He cannot discuss.
Please, wait.
And Nishikant Dubey, point of order.
The minister is on his legs. Please, one second.
Yes, Minister.
352.5. 352 point of order, 352.5.
Yes. Prem Chandra ji. She cannot discuss.
352.5.
The Chief Justice of the Chief Justice of India.
Let the Minister
here. Let... Without giving the prior notice and approval of your chair.
Please, Honorable, please, Mahu Maitra ji, please be seated. Please be seated. This house is run by the rules and procedure. When a member seeks a point of order, definitely it is a right of the member. So I have to hear them and I will pass the order, pass the rulings. Please.
352.5. A member while speaking shall not reflect upon the conduct of a person in high authority unless the discussion is based on a substantive motion drawn in proper items. Chief Justice of India ko hum log yahan discuss kar rahe hain sir. Chief Justice of India, Bharat ke Rashtrapati ne us aadmi ko nominate kiya hai. Bharat ke Rashtrapati ke upar discussion kar rahe hain sir. Aur yadi isi tarah se chalta raha to is democracy ka baaja bach jayega. Isiliye ki unhone Ram Mandir ka jazba.
See. Yes, I am. Yes. Yes, please. Please, Saugatraya ji, please. Please. Saugatraya ji, please. Please. Hey, please.
चार बार नहीं सर हमें
सौगराई जी आप
सर
आप बोलिए ना आप बोलिए
दैट मेंबर इज शाउटिंग
आप प्लीज प्लीज
सर
अंडर व्हाट रूल
ऑनरेबल मेंबर अंडर 352.5
ओ प्लीज
आई एम गोइंग फॉर एन एक्सप्लेनेशन व्हेन द ऑनरेबल मेंबर मोहुआ मोइत्र स्पोक शी डिड नॉट वन रेफर टू एनी पर्सन बाय नेम शी डिड नॉट मेंशन एनीबॉडी एंड व्हाट मेघवाल जी आप कुछ नहीं समझते बैठिए नंबर टू शी रेफर्ड टू अ पर्सन हु वॉज द चीफ जस्टिस इफ दैट मैन वुड बी चीफ जस्टिस नाउ नो मोशन नो मेंशन कुड बी मेड अगेंस्ट हिम एक्सेप्टिंग बाय वे ऑफ इम्पीचमेंट और एक्सेप्टिंग बाय सब्सटेंसिव मोशन दैट मैन इज अ रिटायर्ड चीफ जस्टिस He is not a man in high authority and his name has not been mentioned, not one word of what Mohua said should be expunged. I appeal to your good sense, sir, and your fair play and justice
that don't let this
lady be stifled by the minions of this ruling party.
Yes, Honorable Minister.
मैं ये कह रहा था चेयरमैन साहब ये जो माननीय सदस्य बोल रही थी इसने सेक्सुअल हरेसमेंट का आरोप लगाया चीफ जस्टिस ऑफ इंडिया पे ये हमारे लिए शर्म की बात नहीं है और इस हाउस में हम डिस्कस कर रहे हैं और स्वागत राय जैसे आदमी इसको डिफेंड कर रहे हैं ये इतने विद्वान आदमी इनको डिफेंड कर रहे हैं ये तो सेम फुल एक्टिविटी है आप चीफ जस्टिस ऑफ इंडिया पे सेक्सुअल हरेसमेंट का आरोप लगा रहे हैं ओपनली
Mahu Maitra ji, please.
It is a misconduct of the member.
Let me pass the observation of the chair. We will go through the proceedings. If anything it is affecting the higher authority and anything which is unparliamentary, definitely it will be looked into and it will be corrected. Please try to avoid such observations.
No, sir.
Okay.
Sir, it is extremely important that I not only not avoid, please sir, it is very important that I not only not avoid them, but I bring them up, because I did not accuse the honourable gentleman of sexual harassment.
Please, please.
Somebody else did. A trial happened which he presided over. Number one, let me put it on record. I did not. It is a matter of great shame that someone sitting in the Chief Justice of India's chair, to which he had been appointed by the President of India, was accused of such a horrible act. I did not do it.
Please.
Instead, let migrants walk to their death.
Repeating the target.
Let our greatest activists and modern freedom fighters rot in jail.
She is repeating the target.
It now sits back as
she is not obeying the order. Chairman sir, she is not obeying the order. Chairman sir, she is not obeying the order. Again, she is repeating.
See, anything objectionable will not be there on the records. Please.
Sir,
obeying the order of the chair also.
No, anything.
She is again repeating the same target against the Chief Justice of India.
Excuse me, sir.
Please, Mava Maitraji, please be seated.
Excuse me, sir.
Please.
Sir, you are welcome. Sir, happy.
Mava Maitraji. You have already made your observation.
Yes, sir.
Please, let me continue with my speech.
Please have the patience to hear the chair, please. Yes, sir.
Please, let me continue. See, the matter is, there is...
Let me continue my speech, sir.
Please, Mr. Chairman, wait.
Thank you.
Don't be so...
Instead...
What, madam?
The judiciary stopped being sacred when it chose to squander the greatest opportunity any bench of the highest court of land has ever seen.
Mahomaitraji, please... Please address to the chair. Please hear the chair. Please be seated. Please be seated for 1 second. See, the matter is
356. I'm calling 356.
Yes.
356. The speaker, after having called the attention of the house to the conduct of a member who persists in irrelevance or in tedious repetition, either in own arguments or the arguments used by other members in debate, may direct that member of discontinue the speech. Again she is repeating, sir.
Yes.
Aapke observation ke baad, again she is repeating.
Nishikant Dubey ji, wait. Nishikant Dubey ji, we have already disposed of the issue.
Yeah.
See, if anything objectionable to the higher authority regarding the Chief Justice, any allegation is... Please. Definitely the chair will... The chair will go through the proceedings. If anything is objectionable, definitely it will be expunged. Yes, please continue and please don't repeat it.
Sir, the judiciary stopped being sacred when it chose to squander the greatest opportunity that any bench of the highest court of this land has ever seen to reinforce the founding principles of our democratic republic and to uphold the rights enshrined in Part 3 of our Constitution. Instead, it let migrants walk to their deaths, it let our greatest activists and modern fighters rot in jail, and it now sits back as a mute spectator when our young are prosecuted for cracking a joke. The judiciary seems to have forgotten the constitutional principle of separation of powers, that Parliament and Parliament alone can legislate. If something is bad in law, then the courts can strike it down or stay it on grounds of unconstitutionality. But unless it is so, the courts must do nothing. The government alone must face the consequences. If the government has brought in the farm laws which are not acceptable to people, then either the government will repeal the laws or the courts or the people will vote the government out. We urgently need the sagacity and courage shown by the high courts during the emergency when they delivered ADM Jabalpur and like decisions. The Supreme Court, unfortunately, is failing the common citizen and is being perceived as protecting the privilege and, ironically, only itself. A very large section of the Indian media has plummeted to new depths, both in terms of lack of factual reporting as well as the total absence of journalistic ethics. And yet, even when the bar is so low, the WhatsApp chat leaks detailing correspondence between a large government-leaning media channel and the head of the TV ratings agency expose the utter filth and the crony capitalism that, ironically, this government claimed to be saving us from. What is left of the resilient media is being targeted with the provisions of the UAPA and other draconian laws. You keep taunting the Congress about the emergency, but India today is in a state of undeclared emergency. But the government has miscalculated. There is a fundamental difference between cowardice and courage. The coward is brave only when armed with power and authority. The truly courageous can fight even when unarmed. Do not forget this. Do not forget this when you tell the authorities in Ghaziabad to clear the protest site overnight with the help of the police and the bureaucracy. You are not being courageous. You are a coward wielding power. The truly brave came in droves from villages wielding nothing but the belief that their cause is just. They were propelled by the spontaneous tears of their leader, not by the force of their water cannons. Do not forget this when you block the roads and cut the internet off in 17 of Haryana's districts. You are not being brave. You are a coward yielding power. The state of Haryana gives 10% of India's air force and contributes to 11% of the total strength of the Indian Navy. Its people can neither be termed anti-national, nor terrorists, nor gaddars. Do not forget this. When a peaceful 60-day movement is insidiously hijacked and then you slap FIRs on Punjab's farmers, you are not being courageous. You are a coward wielding power. Bhagel Singh and Jassa Singh Ahluwalia, leading their missiles, captured Delhi way back in 1783 from the Mughals. Their descendants do not lead a lesson in courage from those who captured Delhi only in 2014. Tagore, in his poem, Bondi Beer, The Captive Warrior, an ode to Sardar Banda Singh Bahadur, wrote, Eshe sheshe ek din, jibon mrittu pai ritto chitto bhavona heen, eshe sheshe ek din. That momentous day has arrived. In the 125th year of Subhash Chandra Bose's birth, the central government has made every attempt to hijack Netaji's legacy and weave it into their own fake, narrow narrative of courage. But this nation needs to know that Netaji had two clarion calls, both embodiments of his courage and his spirit. One was the salutation, Jai Hind. Today, this government has replaced this national greeting with a narrow religious chant that it uses as a war cry to heckle, to bully, and to always, always remind the minority about who's in charge. Netaji's second call was Dilli Chalo. Chalo Dilli. This government falls over itself to pay lip service to Netaji. But in truth, you block the borders in Singhu, in Ghazipur, in Tikri with walls and spikes for all those who actually want to come to Dilli to tell you that much like Subhash Chandra Bose, they too will not accept any halfway house. Netaji told us never to lose faith in the destiny of India, and it is not India's destiny to be ruled by cowards. The time has come for us all to show courage.
Please conclude.
Girte hai shahsawar maidan-e-jang mein, wo tifl kya gire jo ghutno ke bal chale? Repeal or nothing. Thank you.